I'd like to show you my latest project. This computer, built using just TTL chips and memory chips. This is the final design, constructed using 3 printed circuit boards and 63 chips. I'll demo this later in the video. There were earlier versions of this computer. Here's the prototype on a large breadboard. This let me troubleshoot the design by allowing me to easily change the connections as needed. There was also an earlier version where I simulated the design of the computer in software using a program called Logisim. So what are TTL chips anyway? Well, to answer that, I'd like to give you a brief history of the electronic digital computer.
The earliest computers were built in the mid-1940s using vacuum tubes. There were earlier analog, mechanical, and electromechanical computers. But the first fully electronic digital computers were built with vacuum tubes. These computers were huge, hot, power-hungry, and unreliable. In the 1960s, transistors quickly replaced vacuum tubes, since they didn't suffer from these disadvantages. Then, in the mid-60s, dozens to hundreds of transistors were integrated into silicon wafers. These TTL chips were used to build computers more efficiently than was possible using individual transistors. TTL stands for transistor-transistor logic, which is a way of connecting transistors to perform digital logic operations. TTL chips are primitive, with each chip containing only a few logic gates. Soon, microprocessor chips containing thousands of transistors appeared. Microprocessors did not eliminate TTL chips completely, as TTL chips were still used to provide the glue logic between the microprocessor and other components in the computer. Over the past decades, microprocessor chips have become increasingly capable and complex. More recently, almost all of the computer's components have been integrated into a single chip called a system-on-a-chip, or SoC. It has been almost 60 years since TTL chips were first used to build computers. I wanted to see how difficult it would be to create a computer using just TTL chips and memory chips. One potential difficulty was parts availability. Fortunately, most of the TTL chips needed are still being manufactured and are readily available. A few chips were not available, but I found online suppliers who stockpile obsolete chips, so I was able to source everything needed to build my TTL computer. Here's the computer in operation. It's running software I wrote to emulate a basic calculator. This is not particularly useful, but it demonstrates that the computer works and can do non-trivial things. I'll enter 22 divided by 7 equals, and here is the result. Here's what the software looks like. It is written in assembly language, where each line corresponds directly to one computer instruction. I also wrote an assembler program that runs on a PC. The assembler translates the assembly language program into binary machine code that can be loaded into ROM and executed by the computer. Let's take a closer look at the hardware. This top board provides the user interface needed for a calculator. The keypad is built using an array of push buttons mounted to the board with a flexible plastic sheet on top to label each button. Let's remove the top board. The middle board contains the ROM and RAM memory chips. The computer has a 16-bit data bus, so pairs of 8-bit memory chips are required. The calculator software needs less than 4 kilobytes of ROM and only 200 bytes of RAM, so this amount of memory is unnecessary, but these parts were the easiest to source. Early microprocessors had an 8-bit data bus and a 16-bit address bus, so they performed a mixture of 8 and 16-bit operations. For this computer, I decided to use 16 bits for both the data and address buses. This allows for a simplified design, since all operations are done using 16 bits. The clock resides here. It runs at a paltry 100 kHz, but this is fast enough for the calculator software. I've tried running the computer at higher clock speeds using an external signal generator. I found that the computer can run reliably at over 3 MHz. At this speed, I believe it would have performance similar to 8-bit microprocessors from the early 1980s, although some tests would be needed to confirm this. There are also buttons on the board to reset the computer and to single-step the clock to troubleshoot problems. There are LEDs to monitor the address and data buses, useful for troubleshooting. There is also a 5-volt power connector and a connector that the top board plugs into. The bottom board contains an 8K ROM for microcode, although only 4K is actually used. The computer uses a microcode architecture, which means that the sequence of hardware signals required to execute each instruction is stored in ROM. Here are the ALU chips, which perform arithmetic and logical operations. Each chip operates on 4 bits, so 4 chips are needed to perform 16-bit operations. Looking closer at this chip, we see the date code P7714, which indicates that this chip was manufactured in the 14th week of 1977, around 47 years ago. This board has troubleshooting LEDs to monitor the microcode address and a connector that the middle board plugs into. It took a while to create these moderately complex printed circuit boards, since I did not have much prior experience. Fortunately, I found that the Easy EDA design software was easy to use, as its name implies. I entered the schematic diagram for each board, specifying what chips were used and how they were connected. I then specified how the chips were arranged on the board. Once this is done, it is necessary to route the board. This is the process of determining where the copper tracks must go on the top and bottom layers of the board in order to satisfy the schematic connections. Skilled people can do this manually, but since I did not have experience, I used software to automatically route the board. I used open source software called Free Routing. Here, it is beginning to route the board, which proceeds quickly at first, but slows to a crawl later when it gets increasingly difficult to route new connections. The program uses many gigabytes of RAM and can take an hour or more to route the board. Once the design was complete, I uploaded the files to the JLC PCB website. Less than 2 weeks later, I received 3 boards, ready for components to be soldered. In total, the parts cost around $125. The printed circuit boards cost $35 plus $30 for shipping. That's a total of $190, probably more than you'd want to pay just to have a basic calculator. But it was a fun and educational project. Thanks for watching. I hope you found this interesting.